Hello everyone, this is my lecture 23 in control systems lecture series. So I am going to give a presentation on PD, PI and PID controllers. The learning objectives of this presentation are to analyze the effect of proportional plus derivative, proportional plus integral and proportional plus integral and derivative controllers. That is the first objective. Second objective is to analyze the effect of derivative feedback control. This introduction we have already shown in lecture 20 when I introduced the compensators. Just by varying the system parameter, we cannot achieve the desired specification always. Therefore, we have to add additional elements, I said. So in the classical control, the significance is more emphasized only in design of the controller or compensator for a particular application. So when we choose the controller or compensator properly, we can achieve the control task as per our expectation, so that the system will be suitable for the particular application for which it is designed. The basic control actions such as proportional plus derivative control, proportional plus integral control, proportional plus integral plus derivative control. So in short, PD control, PI control, PD, PID control are more commonly employed in various industrial applications. First let us see the proportional controller. So there is an error which is coming out of the summing point. So this error is actually amplified by the proportional gain, which is given by Kp, and that Kp multiplied by the error is the modulating signal or the control signal that activates the plant. So the relationship between the modulating signal or the control signal and the error is U of t. So it is also represented by U of t or M of t equal to Kp into E of t. So this is shown in the S domain. So in time domain, E of t multiplied by Kp equal to M of t, where Kp is the proportional gain. So this Kp is nothing but an amplifier with the adjustable gain. Suppose we use a derivative controller, simple derivative controller, the role of Kp is replaced by S into Kd. That means the error is differentiated. That means instead of Kp into E of t, M of t in time domain will be Kd multiplied by dE by dt. Integral controller, the error is going to be integrated. So error, we have to integrate. So Ki into integral E of t dt. Anyway, we don't normally use this proportional controller, derivative controller, integral controller separately. We combine proportional derivative or proportional integral, or we combine all the control actions. Let us see one by one. First, let us discuss the proportional plus derivative controller, PD controller. So this is the plant, this is the feedback power transfer function, this is the controller. So instead of compensator, we have controller. So it is a proportional plus derivative. So Kp is the proportional gain. So S into Kd, that means we have to differentiate. So differentiation is multiplication in S in with S in S domain. So the control law is Kp into E of t plus Kd into dE by dt. That is why we get S into Kd. So where Kp is proportional gain, Kd is derivative gain. So if we take the Laplace transform, so M of s is equal to Kp E of s plus Skd E of s. Therefore, M of s by E of s equal to Kp plus S into Kd. This Kd can be written as Kp multiplied by Td, where this Td is called the derivative time or the set time. Therefore, when we deal with the proportional plus derivative controller, we should see Kp as well as Td. So by choosing the appropriate values of Kp and Td, we can get the desired control action from the proportional plus derivative controller. To understand the effect of this proportional plus derivative controller, let us consider a second order system for this plant. We know very well that a second order system is given by omega n square by s into s plus 2 zeta omega n. That is omega n square by s square plus 2 zeta omega ns, where omega n is undamped natural frequency of oscillations, zeta is the damping ratio. Now for this plant and this controller, let us see the transfer function. So we can use that block diagram algebra and reduce this transfer function. So in the forward path, kp into 1 plus st will be multiplied by this, that is there. So in the feedback path, it is 1, therefore 1 plus g of s by 1 plus g of s. So on simplifying, that is by taking LCM, we get this. Now this expression can be analyzed further by taking some value for kp. Let us take kp equal to 1. Since we are very much particular with the derivative action, let us take kp equal to 1 for the sake of simplicity. Therefore, this expression becomes 1 plus std into omega n square plus divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n plus td omega n square ts. That is what written here, plus omega n is equal to 0. Plus omega n square. So this is the transfer function. Therefore, the characteristic equation is the denominator polynomial of the transfer function. So that means the characteristic equation, this is actually the characteristic equation with the controller. This is without, this is with the controller. So let me change this. So this is the characteristic equation with the controller. That means after introducing the controller, so s square plus s into 2 zeta omega n plus td omega n square plus omega n equal to 0. So if you compare this with the characteristic equation without controller means s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square equal to 0. That's all. So this will be anyway 1. So the change is, there is no change in omega n, but 2 zeta omega n s is replaced by one extra term. Therefore, this 2 zeta omega n is added with this term. Therefore, omega n, there is no change. Therefore, that extra term I am representing using zeta dash, where this 2 zeta dash omega n is equal to this. Therefore, if we simplify this, zeta dash is equal to zeta plus td omega n by 2. Just by dividing by 2 omega n, we get this. So, zeta is the damping ratio of the system without controller, that is the planned damping ratio, and zeta dash is the damping ratio of the overall system after introducing the controller. So, we find that damping ratio of the controlled system, PD controlled system, is greater than the uncontrolled system. So, damping ratio is increased with the introduction of PD controllers. So, this is one good inference. So rise time, we know what is that. So rise time actually decreases with the introduction of PD controller. This we can understand with the help of a numerical example, which we are going to do at the end. Settling time, we know 4 by zeta omega n for 2% tolerance band. This expression also we know from the second order system. So settling time also decreases with the introduction of PD controller. Anyway, these two we have to see how. Steady state error without controller, we know very well. For ramp input, it is 2 zeta by omega, and we have already done for a second order system what is the steady state error we have done. So with the introduction of PD controller, what happens is we have to derive the expression for steady state error. That is, we can make use of this. This is your transfer, planned transfer function is omega n square by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s multiplied by this. So this is your g of s. So here s into r of s minus the transfer function itself is written, because it is c of s by r of s, c of s by r of s multiplied by r of s, c of s by r of s, this entire thing, I'm sorry. This is c of s by r of s. This c of s by r of s is written here, multiplied by r of s. Even we can write limit s n to 0, s g of s by 1 plus g of s, that also we can use. So r of s equal to 1 by s square, r of s is pulled outside, 1 by s square. Taking LCM and simplifying, we get the steady state error as 2 zeta by omega n. By simplification, as s tends to 0, these two will cancel each other. S will go inside. This s can be cancelled with these two, or this s and this s will go. So this is 0, so this is 2 zeta omega n by this is s tends to 0, omega n square, these two will be 0. So omega n square is 2 zeta by omega n. So steady state error with the controller and without controller remains same. Therefore, there is no change in steady state error. However, rise time and settling time are expected to decrease, that we have to see. Anyway, settling time decreases, we can understand, because damping ratio has increased. Since damping ratio has increased, settling time overshoot would have decreased. Therefore, settling time would have decreased. Anyway, rise time decreases. Normally, when we increase the damping ratio, rise time will increase. However, the transfer function of the plant itself changes the general form. Therefore, there is a possibility for rise time also to get reduced, because it is the numerator is not in the standard form. Right. So the advantage of proportional plus derivative control is damping ratio increased, peak overshoot reduced, rise time reduced, settling time reduced. So steady state error remains the same. However, dynamic error is reduced. Dynamic error is reduced means we have already seen dynamic error. Error between the input and output at any time. Anyway, this is very well known fact, because oscillations are less. Since the damping ratio is high, oscillations are less. Therefore, deviation between the input and output at any time is less. Therefore, dynamic error is less. Let us introduce the proportional plus integral controller. So, proportional plus integral. So, proportional is this Kp, integral is this. Anyway, the control law is Kp e of t plus Ki integral e of t dt. So, error multiplied by Kp. Error is also integrated and multiplied by again. That summation is added. Where Kp is proportional gain, Ki is integral gain. So, this Ki is actually integral gain. So, that also I should change. So this Ki is integral gain. This Ka is Kp by Ta. I am writing this Ka as Kp by Ta, like how I have written Kd as Kp into T. But this Ta is called integral or reset time. But there Td was taken as derivative or set time. So by substituting Ki as Kp by Ta here, and then taking Laplace transformation, so M of s equal to Kp E of s plus Kp by Ta E of s by s. Therefore, M of s by E of s becomes equal to Kp into 1 plus 1 by Sta. Let us consider the same second order system to understand the effect of integral controller. For the sake of simplicity, let us take Kp equal to 1, because we have to understand the function of the integral action. So, 1 plus 1 by Sta, Kp is 1. So, this is your this particular part. This particular part is replaced by this. So 1 plus 1 by Sta replacing this. Right. The plant is same second order. Therefore, this into this forms a closed loop. That is what given here. So again, we can write g of s by 1 plus g of s. We can take LCM and simplify. Then this will be the transfer function. Here we can see a second order system has become a third order system, because I am introducing one polar torsion. There is a polar torsion. Because the polar torsion, it is getting multiplied the denominator, order of the system becomes 1. I think I have already said that when we increase the type of the system, then the order will be affected, system order will be affected. So we should not increase the type of the system beyond a particular value 2. So that we can easily understand here. So we have explained that in stability also, since the second order system has become third order system, it is actually posing a constraint on the stability that we are going to see. Because as far as the second order system is concerned, if all the coefficients are present and all are positive and real, definitely system is stable. But third order system we cannot say like that. It is only necessary condition. So characteristic equation is this. So denominator is 0. So this we are dividing by Ti, then we get this. So by introducing PI controller, order becomes high. The second order has become third order. So order has increased by 1. So system is stable only when, that is, this we can formulate the route array, and we have to find out the first column elements. For if the all the first column elements are positive, then the system is stable. If we find out the route array and formulate the first column elements, we can deduce the condition as 2 zeta omega n cube minus omega n square by T A by 2 zeta omega n greater than 0. If this condition is satisfied, then system is stable. So for that value of zeta omega n T A only, system is stable. So anyway, we cannot go for zeta and omega n variation. We have to fix. Therefore, T A we have to accordingly change. Because system is fixed, we cannot change zeta and omega n. Therefore, what value of Ta makes this as 0, this greater than 0. So that we have to see with the help of an example if possible. Otherwise, we should understand this. So order has become increased by 1. So system becomes unstable. There is a possibility that the system become unstable. Not always unstable. There is a possibility for the system becoming unstable. Let us find out the steady state error as already done. So this is again same way as we have done for proportional plus derivative controller. So S into R of S minus this C of S by R of S into R of S, because R of S minus C of S. So anyway, step input steady state error is 0. Why the step input steady state error is 0? Because PI controller already system is a type 1 second order system. I am adding one more integrator. Therefore, steady state error remains 0. Then when we take the input faster than the step input, for example, without controller, for parabolic input, without controller, if you find out using the second order system, we would have got steady state error infinity. With the PI controller, the steady state error is same expression. Of course, this C of S by R of S will change like this. This I am substituting here. So here I am just taking R of S instead of step input. I am taking parabolic input 1 by S cube. So already 1 by S cube, if I take outside, S into 1 by S cube, 1 by S square. This when you simplify as S tends to 0, you get this. So with the introduction of PI controller, steady state error has decreased from infinity to finite value for a parabolic input. Anyway, for ramp input I have not done. If you see, for ramp input, 2 zeta by omega n is the steady state error. 2 zeta by omega n is the steady state error. Yeah, without controller, even with the controller. Now we are going to have one S in the denominator extra. Of course, there is a change. Since we are going to have one S extra, what happens is the 2 zeta by omega n for ramp input will become 0. So finite to 0 for ramp input, infinity to constant for parabolic input. So steady state error reduced from infinity to finite value for parabolic, finite to 0 for ramp input, but order is increased by 1 and we have to ensure that the closed loop system is not becoming unstable because of the point that we have discussed. So these are some of the observations that we have to make when we take the proportional plus integral controller. Therefore, wherever we want to reduce the steady state error from a finite value to zero or infinity to finite value, definitely we need this integral controller. But there is a problem of stability that we have to understand. Proportional plus integral plus derivative controller, PID controller. So Kp into 1 plus STD plus 1 by ST. Only 1 plus STD present means it is derivative. 1 by STA and 1 present means it is integral. So combination is this. So in time domain it is Kpe of t plus Kdde by dt plus Ka integral e dt. So Kd replaced by Kp dt, Kp by Ta, Ka replacing, Kp by Ta replacing Ka. Where Kp is proportional gain, Td is derivative gain, Ta is integral gain, all that. So Ta is integral time, Td is the derivative time. All those things remain the same as we have seen for proportional plus derivative and proportional plus integral controller. So by taking Laplace transformation and simplifying, we get this controller transfer function. So we have 1 plus STD, 1 by STA, both terms are present, that is why I am getting like this. So this PID controller combines the advantages of PA controller as well as proportional controller. See, proportional controller improves transient response, reduces rise time, reduces settling time, reduces overshoot, but does not reduce steady state error. Steady state error remains the same that we have seen. But when we introduce PA controller, steady state error is reduced. For the same input, steady state error is reduced from finite value to zero, infinity to finite. It is possible. So if I want to improve both, then I have to go for PA as well as PD combination. So such a controller is PID controller. It improves transient as well as steady state response. And one more control is also there, derivative feedback control, also called rate feedback or tachometric feedback control. Why it is called a rate feedback or tachometric feedback? Because the output is fed back through a differentiation, and if it is normally let us say position, then tachometric feedback means it is into S, means S into theta of S, that is d theta by dt. So it is nothing but speed feedback. It is something like speed feedback. That is why it is called rate feedback. So differentiation means rate. So this is the normal loop, this is the inner loop. So I have the second order system in the innermost loop. So innermost loop, the feedback is the rate feedback. So I have two summing points because of that. Now error is R of S minus this C of S, and control signal is that error signal to be this particular system is E of S minus SKT C of S. So that is your EC of S. So error controller, right? So if we take simplification of this, if we simplify this, G of S is this, H of S is this. So if you simplify this, G of S by 1 plus G of S, H of S, we get this transfer function. Therefore, the transfer function of the overall system with the derivative feedback control or rate feedback control is this, G of S by 1 plus G of S formula. So the characteristic equation is this, that is what written here. So the new damping omega n, there is no change. So zeta dash is this divided by 2 omega n, because 2 zeta dash omega n is this, like PD control, a term is there. But instead of Kd, you have Kt. So 2 zeta omega n plus omega n square Kt by 2 omega n. So here again the damping ratio is increased with the derivative feedback control. So it is not derivative control, it is derivative feedback control. So I should make a note. So here again I can write derivative feedback control. So damping ratio is increased like derivative control. So it is a derivative feedback control, of course. But like derivative control, here again damping ratio is increased. So overshoot is decreased. But we are going to see that rise time is increased here compared to proportional plus derivative control. Rise time is increased in the derivative feedback control. So we can find out E of S by R of S. Right. So that we can simplify all that. And finally, E of S by R of S, that is this relation, E of S by R of S will be 1 by 1 plus G of S H of S. This we know very well, error transfer function. So this only is written here. So this is E of S, R of S. So this loop is written like this. So instead of writing C of S by R of S, error transfer function is written, that's all. So this is written, so 1 by 1 plus G of S H of S. Right, so if you take LCM and simplify, you will get like this. For step input, so R of S is 1 by S here. So we know very well that it is a type 1 system, second order system. So step input definitely steady state is 0, we can verify it. For ramp input, so here R of S is going to be E of S by R of S is this. So R of S is 1 by S square. Therefore S square will cancel with this S and this S. Therefore as S tends to 0, this will be 0. This will be 2 zeta omega n plus kt omega n square. And these two terms will be 0, so omega n square. Therefore 2 zeta omega n plus kt omega n square by this we will get. That is what written here. So 2 zeta omega n plus kt. Almost similar to what we got in derivative control, but different, slightly different expression. So steady state error for ramp input, we got 2 zeta by omega n. In ramp input, steady state error was 2 zeta by omega n with the derivative control. Without derivative control also 2 zeta omega n, but here kt is extra. That means steady state error is increased in derivative feedback control. Rise time is increased in derivative feedback control, but damping ratio is increased, overshoot is decreased. So only these two advantages we have in the rate feedback control or tachometric feedback control or derivative feedback control. Let us understand this with the help of an example. So transfer function is given, damping ratio, desired damping ratio is 0.8. For derivative feedback constant, find the derivative feedback constant kt. Compare rise time, peak time, overshoot and steady state error for ramp input without and with derivative feedback control. So we know that the characteristic equation is this. So this is of this form. Therefore we can find out 2 zeta omega n equal to 1.6. Therefore omega n square is 16. So omega n is 4. So 2 zeta omega n is 1.6, so substituting that we get zeta 0.2. So without derivative feedback control, zeta is 0.2 and omega n is 4 radian per second. Now I am using with derivative feedback control. So if I use derivative feedback control, zeta dash is this formula. So this formula I have substituted, that's all. So 0.8 equal to 0.2 plus 4 into kt by 2. So omega n remains the same. So derivative feedback constant is 0.3. So first part is determined. Now without derivative feedback control, what is rise time? Without derivative feedback control, rise time, we know this expression from a second order system. Same second order system is given. Pi minus tan phi by omega d. Tan inverse of root of n minus zeta square by zeta. So I am using without controller. So that formula I am using. Similarly, peak time pi by omega d, same omega and zeta I am using. Peak overshoot 100 e power minus zeta by root of n minus zeta square. And steady state error for ramp input is 2 zeta by omega n. So I make use of those expressions. So when I find out rise time is 0.45 second, peak time is 0.8 second, peak overshoot is 52.6, steady state error for ramp input is 0.1. Now let us see what will happen with the derivative feedback control. With the derivative feedback control is the transfer function, because this transfer function we have already, this transfer function we have written, that only is again rewritten. So we know zeta omega n kt of uncontrolled system, that only this zeta, so 0.2 omega n, all that, this only we are writing, put together altogether 2 zeta dash omega n, right? So now the transfer function after substitution we get like this. So 16 by s square plus 6.4 s plus 16 divided by this. So here omega n is root 16.4, same omega n, but 2 zeta omega n is 6.4. previously 2 zeta omega n is 1.6, now 2 zeta omega n is this, and we can find out that the damping ratio is 0.8. so the damping ratio is increased to 0.8, and because of that, what is the rise time? The rise time, the formula if you use, 1.04 second, peak time 1.3 second, overshoot 1.52%, steady state error 2 zeta omega n plus kt. We know one term was extra with the control, so substituting that, so we got rise time, peak time, overshoot, settling time, steady state error. We already got all those values without control. Now we combine this, we are putting in the form of a table. So we have expected the damping ratio to be 0.8, that is how we have designed, so we got it correctly, because based on that only we have taken the value of kt. So these are the tabulated values for without derivative feedback. With derivative feedback, this same values whatever we have written here. So we can find that damping ratio has increased, that's an improvement, but rise time has decreased, rise time has increased, settling time has increased, so it is not an improvement, performance has been affected. Overshoot has come down, it's good indication. Steady state error is increased, it's a bad indication. That is why I said in a derivative feedback control, rise time, peak time will be more, steady state error also more, only damping ratio is increased, overshoot is increased. That is what I have shown at the end. Yeah, in the derivative, yeah, damping ratio increase, overshoot decrease, but steady state error is increased, rise time is increased. So that is why this derivative feedback control cannot be used in places where we have to improve the transient response. Right. Let us understand proportional plus derivative control with the help of an example. So same second order system, whatever we have considered for the previous problem. Now we have to find out the value of TD, rise time, peak time, overshoot for the system. Again, we want the damping ratio to be at the same value. Without derivative control, with derivative control, find out rise time, peak time, overshoot. Now I take the input to the system as step input. Instead of ramp input, step input is taken. So closed loop transfer function is, we can find out omega n, that formula we can find out, omega n square base square plus 2 zeta omega n plus omega n square, same thing, we will get that. So characteristic equation, denominator polynomial is 0. So omega n square is 16, 2 zeta omega n, same problem. So up to this, zeta equal to 0.2, there is no change, same thing. Yeah. Now zeta dash is zeta plus omega n td by 2. This is different, because I am using a derivative control. Earlier I was using derivative feedback control, so this is derivative control. Yeah. So td also same, why it is same? Because KD role is played by TD, that's all. Up to this same, thereafter things will change. Now rise time, pi minus tan inverse of root of 1 minus zeta square by zeta by omega d omega in root of 1 minus zeta square. Now without control it is 0.45 second, peak time 0.8 second, peak overshoot 52.6%. So that is also same because same system. So without control there is no change. With the control, when I want to do, since my numerator is changed, my numerator itself is changed, the transfer function, the numerator itself, Kp into 1 plus STD. We don't get such an expression, we don't get such an expression in derivative feedback control. Derivative feedback control, numerator remains the same. Here, numerator also changes in derivative control. Numerator changes, Kp into 1 plus STD omega n square by, this we have seen, C of s by R of s, for a derivative feedback control, sorry, derivative, PD control, we have seen, what is that? Yeah, this expression, 1 plus STD omega n square divided by this, Kp into, of course. That is why we have to determine from the fundamentals. Yeah. So that expression we have done, assuming Kp equal to 1, because that nothing is given in the problem regarding Kp, nothing is given in the problem, Kp is taken as 1. So C of 1 by s into this, this we can split it into two forms, this we can split it into two forms, 16 by this, 16 into 0.3, 4.8. So I can take partial fraction for this, I can find out the residues of the partial fraction, then I get this function. So from this function, again I should bring it to the standard form, then only I can do the inverse Laplace transformation. So this is s square plus 6.4s plus 16, so I write s plus 3.2 whole square, so s square plus 6.4s plus 3.2 square. So 3.2 square is something but 16, so 3.2 square is subtract, so I have added, subtracted. Similarly I am doing here also. So after doing that simplification, I get 1 by s minus s plus 3.2 plus 3.2 divided by this plus this, because this has been split up into two forms. Why this is split up into two forms? Because from this I have s plus zeta omega in whole square. Here also I should have s plus zeta omega, then only standard form. So s plus 3.2, s plus 3.2, s plus 3.2 whole square plus. So this, what I am doing is, this 3.2 I write with this, so minus 3.2. This, that is s plus 3.2 divided by this, this minus 3.2 plus 4.6 is plus 1.6. So s plus 3.2 plus 3.2 minus s plus 3.2 comes here, minus 3.2 plus 4.8 is plus 1.6. That is how I combine. So this is standard form, s plus zeta omega n whole square plus omega d square plus s plus zeta omega n. That is first shifting principle I can use. So here I have this zeta omega, that is this form, but this 1.6 is not constant, I should have, it's not standard, so I should have 2.4 in the numerator. So divide both numerator and denominator by 2.4, that I have done. So here I am using the first shifting principle. Suppose this 3.2 is not there, then s by s square plus 2.4 square, s by s square plus 2.4 square means cos 2.4t, that's all, cos 2.4t, s by s square plus 2.4 square in s domain. But here I am multiplying by e power minus 3.2t, that means replacing s with s plus 3.2, because minus 3.2t means minus 3 plus 3.2, first shifting principle. So here again this form. If I forget this 3.2, so 2.4 by s square plus 2.4 square means sine 2.42 on Laplace transformation 2.4 by s square plus 2.4 square. So here I want this, therefore I multiply by e power minus 3.2t, replace s with s plus 3.2t. 1.6 by 2.4 is 0.66. So that is how, of course, 1 by s on inverse Laplace transformation 1. So that is how I get c of t like this. Now I want to find out the rise time. Rise time means time taken by the system response to reach 100% of the steady state value in the first attempt for underdamped system. We are doing underdamped system only. So equated to 1. So 1, 1, 0. They cancel each other. This is 1. So e power minus e power 3.2 dr cos 2.2 plus this. So if you bring this to the, this is 110, this you bring it to the this side, this e power minus this, they will cancel each other. So cos 2.4 tr equal to 0.66 sine 2.24 tr. So if you simplify, that is tan 2.24 tr is equal to 1 by 0.66. from that, if you take tan inverse by keeping the calculator in radians mode, we can find out the radian rise time as 0.41 seconds. Then I want peak time. So differentiate c of t expression with respect to t and equate to 0, like what we have done in a second order system without controller. So we are using UV rule, so you can differentiate this. Then if you simplify, you get tan of 2.4 tp equal to this after simplifying this. So we get a minus sign. So tan inverse of minus means it is 180 minus theta. So 180 minus tan inverse of 17.07 by 2.4 by simple mathematical calculations. So it is 0.68 seconds. So peak value of the response is 1.0812 by substituting this peak time in this expression. Substitute peak time as 0.68 seconds here, that is t, this t, this t, you substitute and find out c of t. It is 1.0812t. So peak value of the response minus steady state value divided by steady state value multiplied by 100 is the peak overshoot. Therefore 8.12%. So now we can see peak overshoot. We have computed peak time, rise time, then we know the damping ratio. Same thing has been tabulated. Yeah, this we have already seen. 0.8, 0.41, 0.68, 8.12%. Yeah. 0.68, 8.12%, 0.41, yeah. So rise time has come down, peak time has also come down, overshoot has also come down, zeta has also improved. Therefore, I can say that the system has improved the transient response. So transient response is better. So what we can understand from these two problems is we can use proportional plus derivative controller wherever we want to improve the transient response, but steady state error remains unaffected. And if you are using proportional instead of proportional plus derivative control, if you are using derivative feedback control or rate feedback control, naturally the steady state error will increase. Rise time, peak time also will increase, but overshoot and zeta only will, overshoot will reduce, zeta will improve, like PD control. And in integral controller, definitely stability is a problem. So for which numerical example has not been done because we have already understood. So wherever you want to improve the transient response, go for proportional plus derivative control. I think we have covered almost all the lectures in the classical control. So we will concentrate on state space also in future videos. We'll also introduce solutions to some of the gate problems based on whatever lecture videos we have already released for the classical control. And we will plan for some of the simulations using MATLAB to understand this transient response, frequency response, then this PID controller, then Laglede composite design, all that Bode plot, Nyquist plot, everything we'll do with the help of MATLAB also. So that we will do in the future videos. Thank you.